into the tumor. We want to look really how the tumor dissemination patterns look into reality and see how this will direct us. And of course, at the end, I mention the first, which is the clinical examination, which sometimes we tend to forget in an era of highly specialized imaging. If you see in the literature, the massive variety of tumor markers that exists is so much new coming every day. The most important for ovarian cancer, for ovarian tumors, is the CA125, which is not really absolutely specific for ovarian cancer. It's also for any peritoneal dissemination. This is why it's elevated in inflammation, in peritoneal mesothelioma, in pregnancy even. So this is something still, however, which is currently playing the most important role in our clinical management and especially in the follow-up. And of course, we have now moved on to more specialized things like the ROMA index, the RMA, HE4, which also combined try to give us a higher sensitivity and higher specificity, shown here, highly diverting, also different sometimes in pre- and postmenopausal women. I'm not going to go further into that because I'm sure you will hear it from other speakers, and I wanted to give you a bit more different approach. A revolution that has been brought up to us was the IOTA study. We are in an IOTA conference. It was. It is very simple and very revealing and relieving for us simple clinicians and surgeons to have somebody who can tell us with very simple rules and very strict criteria, actually, what our patients have and how we can direct them. It is also important not to just direct and see the ovarian masses, but also what is around these ovarian masses. For example, when women come to me to be operated, they usually have the diagnosis of ovarian cancer or of borderline. And what I usually look is not really the actual tumor anymore, but I go away from the tumor. And we see peritoneal carcinosis in the pouch of Douglas. Dirk already talked about the peritoneal carcinosis in the Morrison's pouch. Around the splenic area, where within 5 minutes you can really, without any CT or any MRI or PET CT, just put the scan on the patient's abdomen and see approximately what's happening, what are you going to need to site reduce during your operation within just a few minutes of scanning. We are in an era where we tend to sometimes have the feeling try to over-diagnose and do an over-imaging. We have multidisciplinary tumor boards where we very meticulously think and see not only the clinical picture of the patient, but also every image. We currently in many national and international guidelines, there is the CT chest, abdomen, and pelvis, which is the number one examination that is happening preoperatively in the suspicion, in the high suspicion of advanced ovarian disease. There are some broad national differences. For example, I remember in Germany, we never used to do any CT preoperatively, but we just did an ultrasound and an X-ray of the chest and an ultrasound of the liver to exclude very broad distant mets, liver lung mets, and we would leave it by that. However, the CT is now something that actually needs and has to be done, and usually we try in our clinical management to always incorporate it. However, how accurate is this? There have been many studies, no prospective studies, however, many numerous retrospective studies that actually showed that the CT can be accurate. However, there is a very high discrepancy between different centers, different examiners. We have, for example, this is a UK study comparing two different centers in London and one in Manchester, where they showed the prediction of suboptimal site reduction in 80% in the first case and in 63% only in the second case. So we go away from the imaging anymore to just describe tumor dissemination patterns, but also to really predict our therapeutic success and our operability and how able or not able the surgeon will be to remove this mass. And of course, there are many things that you can check. Ovarian cancer is a disease that loves the peritoneum, goes into the upper abdomen. We have diaphragmatic disease, portal hepatitis disease, small and large bowel mesenteric disease. And what the task of the radiotherapy of radiologists currently is to check these very high special areas of interest and to tell us, listen, you have mesenteric disease, mesenteric root disease, this will be probably inoperable. So how accurate is this? How accurate and how reliable can we as surgeons be sitting in an MDT room, having a radiologist telling us that something is inoperable, which will have massive therapeutic consequences for the patient, and we will direct the patient to no surgery at all, just primary chemo or neoadjuvant chemotherapy, where Professor Fagot is going to talk later about, or to operate her on the first place. So this is a very nice study from Rob Bristow, a multicenter US study, where you see that according to this criteria, no matter if you have this variable present or non-present, actually the prediction of suboptimal site reduction or optimal site reduction was not extremely accurate. And you have, even in large diaphragmatic disease, patients that more than half of the patients could at the end be operated tumor-free. If you go into the trouble and say, okay, I will still try to do that. So what they saw that even 50% of the patients whose preoperative CT scans were positive for a bad predictor like mesenteric root involvement, like large bar mesentery, like diaphragmatic disease, at the end when they did undergo optimal site reductive surgery, they managed to be operated tumor-free. So this means that all these patients would have been withdrawn from an optimal treatment because of an imaging that at the end wasn't completely accurate. And they talk of relatively high false positive rates of more than one third. The authors concluded that one of every three very high risk ovarian cancer patients that were predicted to undergo suboptimal surgery at the end will be in the hands of a specialized surgeon in the specialized center and team, will be able to be optimally site reduced, meaning that we all need to be very careful not to just blindly look at images and trust these images, but also see the whole clinical picture. The same with the PET-CT. The PET-CT is something very new. Depending on the radiologist, we have a great radiologist in our center who would like to do a PET-CT in all ovarian cancer cases. The question is, how accurate is this? We know that in ovarian cancer, especially in low volume, low burden disease, even in advanced stage 4, 3 and 4 disease, where we have very small nodule peritoneal carcinosis, these small nodules cannot really be depicted in PET-CT. And I have not very rarely opened up an abdomen which was supposed to be completely normal in PET-CT, and it was very small nodule peritoneal disease. There are no prospective randomized trials to show the actual predictability of PET-CT. However, the authors in many retrospective analyses, they actually conclude into the same statement that the PET-CT results should definitely not used to withhold patients from their optimal treatment, which would be the optimal site reduction, regardless of the timing. And this is a picture that, for example, I would like to show you. These are two patients with inoperable disease, both of them. However, with a completely different tumor burden of disease. You see here, you see a complete mesenteric disease in everywhere, and also in the small and large bowel serosa, where even if you take things like the plasma jet and try to coagulate everything, you can never get this patient tumor-free. But even if you look at this picture, where initially you look at it, you don't really see anything, but you see these very, very small nodules everywhere, and also it's not very good depicted in this picture, but also the whole small bowel serosa will get that, till the triads. So that we need to be very careful what we see. This, for example, is an image that this woman had a completely normal CT and PET-CT, but was a completely different clinical picture when you open up. In an attempt to try to be more specific in our preoperative imaging and approach, there are many new studies that are coming up. This is a new study from Professor Rockall from our institution, who is going to be who designed a prospective trial of preoperative comparison of CT and MRI, dictating and showing operability. So we will have new data, and there are also other multicenter international studies going towards this direction. However, is this all? Is this all everything about operability? Is this all about only stratifying patients? Let's have a look at two cases. This is a case that I was back in the Charité some years ago. It was a 59-year-old postmenopausal woman with a 5-centimeter ovarian cyst and postmenopausal bleeding, normal tumor marker. She had an ultrasound back then, which showed an endometrioma. We have a very good, he's not an IOTA scanner, Professor Henry, but he's a very good scanner. And he said it's just an endometrioma. So the patient underwent, even though she was postmenopausal and she didn't really, she couldn't have any kids anymore, she had a laparoscopy and a DSC. The uterus was perforated. Then she had a laparoscopy, the cyst was ruptured. They did a unilateral salpingophorectomy because they couldn't proceed because of infections, because of bleeding, so it was abandoned. The final histology showed an 1C endometrioid ovarian cancer, which was iatrogenic 1C. And the patient had to be laparotomized later in order to have a completion surgery with a complete removal of a pelvic clearance. Got an abscess due to an ileocecal tumor that wasn't seen initially in the laparoscopy and in the preoperative imaging. She got an anastomosis, she got leaking and sepsis and had multiple laparotomies. So you start from a very small case for a very small cyst and it ends up in a disaster. Second case, not in Berlin, 39-year-old patient with very high active childbearing wish, newly gravida. She was admitted to an oncology hospital because of a hydronephrosis and a pelvic mass with suspicion of high suspicion of ovarian cancer. She got a nephrostomy, she got a CT. The CT showed suspicious pelvic and paraortic lymph nodes, infrarenal lymph nodes, large ovarian mass. So she was admitted for a pain control, for initially stabilization, MDT was on the ward till we have an accurate slot to put her in the ward. And what happened, at some point she developed on one evening an acute abdomen. We emergently laparoscopized it, and we actually just saw a tortured necrotic tumor with a dermoid in the final histology, and just reactive lymph nodes. In the sampling that we did. So where it was cancer suspicious, it actually wasn't. What do these two cases show us? These cases show us that actually the questions that we really need to ask, it's not just a question of operability and what we see, but it goes more than that. It goes to what are the symptoms of the patient? How is the whole clinical picture? Does the patient want a fertility sparing surgery, yes or no? Most importantly, does she want a one or a two-stage procedure? Distant meds, and I'm coming back to the example of Germany where we just did an X-ray and an ultrasound of the liver to see just if this patient will have distant meds and then just go ahead and operate her. The fertility sparing approach is an issue that is being more increased now. We have germ cell tumors, we have borderline tumors in younger patients. And there are many algorithms and many approaches that have been developed of conservative surgery versus radical surgery. I always try to say to my trainees that fertility sparing surgery can be radical, doesn't need to be conservative. So I will show you some pictures where you can be radical, you can strip the peritoneum and still preserve fertility. Like for example here, this is a patient with invasive implants from a borderline tumor. Who had a unilateral salpingophorectomy, the other ovary was normal, and we stripped the entire pelvic and bladder peritoneum, and also the uterus serosa, if you can see it, in order to remove the implants. Here the same in the pouch of Douglas and cervix. So it's a radical but fertility-sparing surgery. This woman, this picture is approximately 5 years ago, and she emailed me when I'm now in London a couple of years ago that she got pregnant and she delivered and wanted to show me a picture of the baby. And the same also with lymph node dissections in very early stage one ovarian cancers, where you see that even though you have to perform a systematic lymph node dissection to exclude occult stage 3C disease, you have here the preserved ovary, and you can preserve the ovarian veins till the IVC, and you can do a complete systematic lymph node dissection, so a radical surgery, but again, fertility sparing. So it's not a matter radicality is not a matter of what you preserve, but what you need to take out in order to cure your patient. So it's not really a matter of operability. Our aim as gynecology surgeons is more about survival and quality of life. So what impacts survival? What is our aim, the aim of our preoperative diagnosis in order to predict survival? There is no question that in advanced disease, we have the postoperative residual disease, which is one of the most important prognosticators of survival. No question about that. Thousands of patients in a retrospective way. But also we know that preoperative disease matters. Patients with high tumor volume, so with high tumor load, even though they are being operated tumor-free, they will at the end have a worse prognosis than patients with a lower volume disease that are being operated tumor-free. So there is no question about that. And we also know, therefore, that there are many centers that will perform a laparoscopy in order to have a look at the intraoperative, at the intra-abdominal tumor dissemination patterns, and classify the patients to high and low volume tumor burden. And we also know that the lower the tumor burden is in the laparoscopy, the better the patients will do. So that we bring it even further, and we have centers like the MD Anderson, which define algorithms of increasing surgical success in ovarian cancer, in advanced ovarian cancer, and in site reduction rates, showing site reduction rates in more than 80% of the patients, which is massive. However, what happens to the other patients that are not optimally defined in laparoscopy, where you open up and you see everywhere disease? What happens to them? So we talk about increasing of surgical success, but what is really surgical success? Is it a happy surgeon who goes into the abdomen and says, oh, that's tumor-free, that's very low volume disease, I site reduce everything and go home, and then tell to a very happy patient, you're completely tumor-free and all is fine? Is it a matter of money, of happy managers, where you have very small operations in low volume disease, you operate tumor-free in 95% of them, and the patient goes home after 3 days? Or is it really about survival? Also, in more advanced cases with high tumor load, where you have to go into the effort and try to site reduce them. So how do we define good surgical outcome? Do we define the ability of achieving total macroscopic tumor clearance, or just debulking of the disease, removing the bulk of the disease at debulking and at site reduction? So many people would say that very accurate preoperative imaging has the aim of defining and reducing complications. But let's go back and try to redefine again complications. What are complications? We have two types of complications. We have complications iatrogenic induced from very radical surgery and very aggressive approach. But we also have tumors complications induced by the tumor itself. We have tumors like that where you have unblocked resections, like one that Professor Fagot operated yesterday with massive, just infiltrating everything, where you know that if you don't resect that, you will soon have a fistula, you will soon have a bowel perf. Or a picture like that with a disease in the entire abdomen, where it doesn't really matter if you have in the CT mesenteric root carcinosis, because this needs to come out so that the patient feels better at the end. Or a patient with a primary peritoneal cancer and a tumor in the left colic flexure having a massive bowel obstruction with very small, completely not very not full colon descendants, and you have here the massive dilated transverse colon. This patient, even if this patient would have liver mets, she would need to be operated to fix that. But of course, within a completely different approach of not stripping the whole peritoneum, but fix the disease, fix here the area, do an anastomosis and or a stoma, and make the patient better in order for her to be able to get a primary systemic chemotherapy. And of course, we talk about very expensive imaging, we talk about very accurate imaging. We know that complications in ovarian cancer surgery is not really defined by the number of organs you remove and by your radicality, but actually by the tumor itself. Due to the massive volume shifts that you have at primary site reduction with massive ascites and massive pleural effusion, especially in younger and especially in older patients. This is an analysis we did in Berlin on the example of a few hundreds of patients a few years ago, where we showed that regardless of the tumor dissemination pattern and regardless of how much surgery you did, at the end you had just significantly different complications according to how much ascites or pleural effusion the patient had. So you don't really need a CT to see that, or a massive expensive imaging. You just take an ultrasound, which, for example, Ahmed always does preoperatively, and he just sees, does the patient have ascites, does the patient have pleural effusion, and according to just alone that, we just book an ITU bed, or no, we need to be a bit more careful with her. And of course, what is very important is to direct these patients to the right treatment and to the right center. We know that we can have reduction of surgical mobility through specialization. We know that patients that are being treated in a study clinic, in a clinic which specializes in gynec cancers with studies, with active studies, they do better. We also know that the quality of surgery evolves over time. Surgeons get better, but not only surgeons, but also teams and anesthetists. And of course, very important is that preoperative diagnostics is not only just about showing the tumor dissemination pattern, but we undergo currently an era of new personalized medicine with multiple biopsies from the whole abdomen, where we really, before we go into this patient, we have a completely well-defined molecular biological profile of this patient, and we can direct her better. This is an analysis that Charlie Gurley from Edinburgh showed a few years last year in ASCO, where he showed that regardless of the tumor patterns of the disease, regardless of what the imaging showed, regardless of what the surgeon achieved at the end, we had a different survival of different ovarian cancer patients according to the different expression microarray analysis they had, according to which group they were, angio or immune or angioimmune. And you see here highly statistically different survival curves to these patients, just based on their molecular biological profile. And this is a study that we do in Imperial in platinum-resistant disease, where we use imaging and we use CT and ultrasound-guided biopsies in order to perform paired biopsies in platinum-resistant disease for before and after chemo to see what's happening with this tumor and to perform molecular biological analysis and see on a molecular base what's happening. So concluding, it's not about just describing the disease, it's not just about predicting operability, it's about integrating all the current modern diagnostics into an overall clinical management decision and to improve survival and quality of life of these patients. We have to base our decision-making process based on the overall symptoms of the patient's wishes, but also direct them to the right center. We undergo an era where patients with cancer in general, not just ovarian cancer, should not be treated in local hospitals anymore, but in large centers where people have and will have more experience with these diseases. And a completely new approach of imaging and ultrasound-guided biopsies is the preoperative definition of individualized surgical treatment by knowing before you go there how the tumor is on a molecular profile and stratify your patients better. Many thanks.
Christina, thank you very much. Questions? Well, we have one at the front. Antonia Testa. Excuse me, microphone goes to the front. That's great.
Yeah. Hi, Christina.
Good morning.
Antonia.
Okay. The speaker. Christina, I would like to ask you, what is your daily management of your patients? I mean, before going to the surgery with the patient with a suspicion advanced ovarian cancer, in your daily life, do you ask for CT? Do you ask for ultrasound?
Yeah.
Do you ask for what?
It's working? Yeah. Yes. So I'm in England currently. And in the NHS, there are very strict rules how these patients are managed. So defined by the NHS guidelines, all these patients need an MRI of the abdomen, a CT of chest, abdomen, and pelvis. And then after we have the imaging and we see the images, without having seen the patient, after that we see the patient, and we define management. An MRI of the abdomen, I think, should not be necessary. It should be necessary only in young women who wish a fertility-sparing approach, because in ovarian cancer, site reduction is never really an issue of how able you are to remove the pelvic tumor. That's almost always possible. The issue is the upper abdominal disease, the chest disease, and the mesenteric root disease. So we have this data. So when I see these patients, I will always have a CT and an MRI. And then we will direct them towards surgery or no surgery according to how the patient is, what the patient wants, her chronological age, and then go ahead.
When I was listening to your data, I mean, you presented data on CT, which was not very predictive, to say the least. So, I mean, looking at that, the only conclusion one would have is you have to operate on anybody because you can't trust your preoperative assessment in any event if you want to optimally size reduction. You know.
Again, so we are going to have with Ignace later a very good, a discussion about that. What, for me personally, is important in the CT is to exclude massive mediastinal and supraclavicular lymph nodes. So sometimes you have patients like with an armor of lymph nodes in their chest and supraclavicular area. Diffuse liver mets, or if they have liver mets, if they are solitary or if they are localized in one lobe, so that I direct my hepatobiliary surgeons that we need to do a true hepatic resection. lung mets, which are pretty rare. Less than 5% of the patients in primary disease will have true hepatic and lung mets. And lymph nodes, so that I know how high I will go with my lymph node dissection. We know now that in the new FIGO classification, even the suprarenal lymph nodes, celiac trunk lymph nodes, subdiaphragmatic lymph nodes, are not FIGO stage 4 anymore, but 3C. So the same like a pelvic lymph node. So it's important. So my question is always to my trainees, do we have any distant mets? Do we have any lymph nodes? And that's that.
So it's not actually about operability. It's about distant metastases and directing your surgery.
Yeah, and okay. It's about the whole clinical picture, exactly. There are patients that I haven't operated, even though they were operable in the CT, just because they were old, they were bad, they were in a bad performance status, they didn't want the surgery, so you have to see everything.
Mm? Okay, one more comment and we'll move on, because I think we'll be discussing quite a lot of this at the end by the sound of it. So is that okay?
Yeah.